coming up on this edition of Virginia Beach Frontline Firefighter. We meet again with retired VBFD members Murray Laughlin and Steve Miles for part two of a three-part series on the culture of safety in the fire service. Master Firefighter Ned Lowry talks to us about the signs and dangers of heat stress. I'm Master Firefighter Tom Parks. Here's this month's host of Virginia Beach Frontline Firefighter, Art Kahn.
Hi, I'm Art Kahn, the Public Information Officer for the Virginia Beach Fire Department, and welcome to this month's edition of Frontline Firefighter. Last month, you may recall, we met with retired firefighters Murray Laughlin and Steve Miles for a safety stand down. This month, the guys are back to continue their conversation on the culture of safety.
Many departments vary as far as employees, training, equipment goes, and you've seen many changes from the time that you came in the Virginia Beach Fire Department to the time that you retired. Do you see a cultural change in our line of work, and are we making positive changes?
I think the fire service is. As a matter of fact, a document just came out from the United States Fire Administration on the fire service, trying to change the culture of the fire service. It's available now on the USFA website. And kind of the intent of the project, and actually let me back up, this actually started with the National Fallen Firefighters Foundation's 16 initiatives. The first initiative was trying to change the safety culture in the fire service. And it's kind of a collective process. And this document that was just released that I represented NIOSH on the panel is to take a look at what do we need to do collectively, not just the fire chiefs, not just the safety officers, not just middle management, but on a company level, the firefighters, the officer, how do we change that? And there's a couple ways that we're trying to do that. One is, and I think this is one of the biggest things, is empowerment. Is everybody has a responsibility for their safety and for everybody they work with. And as we all know, this is, as being part of the Virginia Beach Fire Department, it's a big family, and we have to take care of each other. And so we empower everyone from Chief Cover all the way down to the newest member of the department. And we look at, you mentioned SCBA, we look at incident command, we look at protective clothing, we look at health maintenance. The department, or the city, has a wonderful health maintenance program, fitness program, vehicle apparatus safety. All those things come into play as we try and change it. Part of the problem is the tradition in the fire service. And one of the issues when I started safety, that was one of the biggest issues people would say, you're taking the fun out of the job. And that was never, ever the intent of the safety program. The best time of my life were the years that I spent here with the Virginia Beach Fire Department, and I'd do it all over again in a minute, and I know Steve would too. But the issue that we're looking at is that we've got to change. On an average, we lose 100 firefighters a year. We have no worldly idea how many injuries occur, and that's one of the projects that we're trying to initiate, a system. The National Fire Protection Association does an annual injury report, but it's just a guesstimation based upon the number of responses that they get. So there's no way to really track that. So those are things that we have to look at, the occupational illnesses. It's so important that's, it all hopefully comes together. And one of the things working in when I worked in this organization, we would try things. If they didn't work, we'd go to plan B or C, but we never gave up. We always continued. And that really reflects on the organization as a whole. So we're making progress. One of the things, the department's what, maybe 40 years old at the most, but we go to departments that are date back to the 1700s, 1800s, where the tradition is truly instilled, and those are things that we're battling. But a lot of the major departments in this country are stepping to the plate and saying there is a better way to do business, and that's part of this culture.
One of the, if I can expand on that, one of the areas that the 100 firefighters a year that are died in the line of duty doesn't include the chronic folks. And chronically, disease is a huge burden on the American Fire Service. So changing the culture will have a huge effect on the untold numbers of folks that have debilitating chronic issues, and they're not acute. You know, we go back to the SCBA usage thing. You can stop an acute incident by mandating everybody wears their SCBA, you know, for this and for that. But if you want to change the culture even further, give them respiratory protection during an overhaul. That doesn't have an acute effect. The picture is not as clear right away, acutely, but it is chronically down the road. And we know all the, you know, the carcinogens, all of the horrible chemicals that are being, you know, released during incomplete combustion, all this synergistic stuff that's going on that we don't understand, but we're exposing our folks to. That is a huge culture that needs to change. And it's through inhalation, and it's through absorption. And I think we're making some headroads in that. I know NIOSH has just recently released some studies that, you know, that point to this high rate of different kind of carcinogens amongst firefighters. And, you know, it certainly makes sense. So changing the culture acutely, you know, to stop a specific incident or to address a specific causation, and then changing the culture to prevent we want you to retire healthy, you know, and, you know, that's where we can have a huge impact. Unfortunately, Murray and I's job here is we are traumatic fatality investigators, so we don't get into any of the chronic or cardiovascular disease and all those kind of things. That's handled out of the Cincinnati office. Good group of folks over there. We have a medical doctor and his staff that do all those. So that's, you know, an area in the future that we really need to have some really great impact in the cultural switch to understanding. You know, I go back to when I was first hired in 1978, we had a huge boiler that heated the whole block down at Company 11. We get back in the wintertime, we throw our coats on the asbestos wrap boiler to dry them out, because nobody likes to go, you know, put on a wet coat to go to the next call. So this whole move of PPE and absorption, you know, cleaning your gear, making sure your turnout gear is clean, we all know it, because we, after you shower and you clean when you get back to the firehouse, the following day you shower and clean, your pores open up, you smell it again. So there's a pretty good indicator that something is getting in through absorption. So the things that you can do to prevent that are, you know, two sets of gear, you know, so you always have one that's clean. You come back off a fire, you gross decon it at the scene, you get back, you put a new set of gear on for your next call. And so those are some of the things culturally. Dirty gear is not a badge of honor.
In talking of culture, you've mentioned everybody from the probationary firefighter up to the fire chief. Do you believe that change can go both ways? Change can start from the bottom and work its way up? Or do you believe it has to come from the top tenured members and go down?
I think it can work both ways. And one of the things when, and I go back to Chief Dizell, when we started the safety program, the intent was this is the standard of safety that we're going to operate within the Virginia Beach Fire Department. This is how we're going to do business. And these are your limitations. And if you deviate past that, then you may have to go in and sit down with somebody and press hard on three copies. But, and I say that jokingly, that's not the intent. The issue is we want people to understand why we're doing things, why we're making these changes. And I can remember company in services, the officer in services that the safety office used to present different programs on. These are changes that we're working on. This is why we're doing it. And as I said, some of them worked, some of them didn't work. Give you an example: flame retardant uniforms. We used to wear. The pants would shrink after you washed them.
Stitching come out.
And we fortunately enough, the bottom line is the standard changed to allow cotton. So, but we tried people. I can remember guys during the summer would wear wool pants. We tried wool T-shirts. It was, and God love them. Everybody was absolutely wonderful. We did the same thing with turnout gear. I can remember we went to leather boots. We tried that. There were a lot of things that we really tried to stay a step ahead, as Steve said. And this issue with turnout gear is a huge issue. And Steve and I are both still involved through the National Fire Protection Association. I know the Protective Clothing Committee is really, that's something that they're looking at based upon the cancer study that came out through NIOSH, through Dr. Hales in Cincinnati. And so this is kind of the next step. We've gotten our basic program into place. Now where do we need to go? And I think the health maintenance is going to be really, really important. And we get a daily news brief every morning from around the country, and it's just amazing the number of departments that are having issues with cancer. And I mean, it affected our department and two wonderful people. And so we've got to really, really focus on that.
Right from the frontline firefighter to the chief of the department, it's hard not to see, how the culture of safety is integrated into a department when we go out. We see it all the time. And Virginia Beach is so fortunate in that the frontline firefighter and the chief of the department and the people that he or she responds to or reports to are all behind. You can see it in this building that we're sitting in. That is safety culture. When you have a training center the size of this training center, the commitment to, allow folks to go down a road that we think we can have an impact and allow them to fail is says a lot about the organization. And we have been fortunate for my whole career that, all of the administrations, Chief Dizell, Chief Cade, Chief Cover, Chief Carter, all of them allowed that. So there wasn't any, there wasn't such a steep ingrained culture that we're not going to look at taking the guys off the tailboard, which somebody did to us. But it was a good move when we look back. Summer of 78, riding down Atlantic Avenue on a tailboard, you couldn't beat it. But it was, it was a national thing. We needed to get off those tailboards. And we needed to stop wearing the mask around our neck and actually put it on. You know, cause the SCBA rule at the time was you carry it with you and you got to have it on your back. Nobody said you had to have your face piece on. So all of those were necessary changes they were both directed from the front line backwards and from the top forward. So, and supported. So it's easy to make a decision when you've got everybody on board with it, because we know we're doing the right thing. It's not a question of, do we want black turnout gear or tan turnout gear? You know, it's not that. It's what's the best turnout gear. You know, we can discuss colors of fire trucks later, but what's the best fire truck? And Virginia Beach is always been fortunate, especially in the SCBA field. We've had a top-notch resource manager here. We've had top-notch input from the field on the best SCBAs you can buy, and we've had them. We've had them right from the days when they were carried in suitcases on the fire trucks, which was just slightly before my time, but I remember seeing them. And it will continue. So it's actually neat to see that. Other departments are not so fortunate. They are forced to get the gear that somebody has given them. And, you know, it may not be the best SCBA. It may only be a 1,200 liter cylinder as opposed to, well, we are asking for 1,800 liter cylinders. You know, those kind of things. So that ability to have input from the front all the way to the top is key.
It's a beautiful summer day out here on the beach right now, but you know, fall is just around the corner. Still, there's plenty of hot weather left to go. That's why Ned Lowry's here to join us to talk a little bit about heat stress.
I'd like to talk to you about heat-related illnesses that can affect you on the job. Hot weather can lead experienced firefighters to heat cramps, heat exhaustion, and heat strokes. Heat cramps are short, severe cramps in the muscles of the legs, arms, or abdomen that can happen during or after heavy exercise and extreme heat. Heavy sweating uses up the body's supply of salt, which causes the cramps. Heat cramps may also lead up to heat exhaustion. Heat exhaustion occurs when a person spends time in a hot environment without drinking enough fluids. Symptoms include extreme thirst, fatigue, weakness, clammy skin, nausea, or vomiting, and rapid breathing. Heat stroke is the most serious heat-related illness, and left untreated for even a short time can cause death or permanent disability. Heat stroke occurs when the body temperature rises too rapidly to as much as 106 degrees within 10 to 15 minutes. The typical symptoms include red, hot, and dry skin, no sweating, and a rapid weak pulse. A firefighter who suffers a heat stroke attack while wearing PPE is very likely not to present the typical hot and dry skin with no visible sweating. Your turnout gear holds in all the heat and moisture, preventing it from evaporating. Thus, a firefighter suffering from heat stroke may likely present with red, moist skin that is hot to the touch. When heat-related illnesses set in, it is important to quickly recognize the signs and apply the proper treatment. Here is a look at how to approach each level of illness. For heat cramps, stop all activity, remove all turnout gear, particularly the protective hood, and sit quietly in a cool place. Drink cool water, a sports drink, or other drinks with no caffeine. Do not resume activity for a few hours after the cramps go away, since heat cramps can lead to heat exhaustion or heat stroke. Get medical help if the cramps do not go away in an hour. To treat heat exhaustion, again, stop all activities, remove all turnout gear, particularly the protective hood, and sit quietly in a cool place. Drink cool water, a sports drink, or other drinks with no caffeine. Sit in front of a cooling fan or mister to help promote sweat evaporation and cool the body. Heat stroke is a time-critical medical emergency. Get the firefighter to a shady or cool area and call for emergency medical assistance immediately. Until they arrive, do the following. Cool the victim as quickly as possible with a cool bath or shower. A spray of cool water from a hose or by wrapping the victim in a cool, wet sheet. Check body temperature often and continue cooling efforts until temperature drops below 102. Do not give any fluids to drink until their body temperature has been lowered. Prevention starts at the beginning of the shift. Heat stress is incredibly dangerous and can turn a routine operation into a serious problem. The good thing about heat stress is that they are completely avoidable with proper precautions. Try to schedule PT and station drills in the cooler part of the day, or on extreme hot days, consider inside drills. Your body needs water to keep cool. Drink plenty of water. This cannot be stressed enough. Start by drinking water once you begin your shift and throughout your shift. Water is one of the main lines of defense. At the same time, try to avoid drinks with caffeine or sugar. Monitor your own body conditions, but also look out for your fellow firefighters. Always work with someone and keep an eye on them. If you notice any of the symptoms for yourself or fellow firefighters, report it. Make sure to wear breathable, loose-fitting clothing and undergarments to help the sweat evaporate. It's important to remember that Support 8 is the fire department's rehab unit. It offers the following for on-scene rehab: a misting fan, cooling chairs, water and snacks, a portable pop-up tent, an awning on the side of Support 8 that extends out. If Support 8 is unavailable, Utility 8 can respond with ice and water only. Support 8 and Utility 8 can be requested at any time, not just for fires, but for any training event requiring rehab. Another important concern is medical monitoring. Virginia Beach EMS will be set up to take vitals and determine if you are clear to engage in fire activities. I hope you enjoyed this segment on heat-related illnesses. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact anybody on the safety committee. Remember, be prepared, be safe, and look out for one another. I'm Master Firefighter Ned Lowry.
Well, that does it for this month's edition of Frontline Firefighter. Thanks for watching. Before we leave, we want to remind you that, as always, if you have any ideas for future episodes of Frontline Firefighter, you can forward those along to Kirk Kellerhals at the contact information you see on your screen. In the meantime, we want to remind you to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and watch us on YouTube. For Frontline Firefighter, I'm Art Kahn.